Welcome inside the digital hub to Denmark. Please welcome to the stage Mo Gaudat.
Hi. I love that animation, by the way. How's lunch? Lunch is good. Everyone's sleepy. You know that lights are in my eyes, so I have no idea what you look like. So if you want to sleep, yeah, good chance. I spent some parts of my life running multi-billion-dollar businesses, which was boring like hell. The fun part was building them. And so I was asked today to come and share with you what I know about innovation. I've applied that to multiple things, including my personal mission of 1 billion happy. But of course, typical of everything in the modern world, regardless of how important a topic is, it's given 25 minutes. So my only answer to that is I'm going to talk very fast. Okay? So follow, and just to make it a fun start, I'll start with a game. And that game I call sci-fi or sci-fact. So in that game, I will look back at some of the science fiction. Any science fiction fans in the audience? There we go, of course, techies. The others that didn't raise their hands, what's wrong with you? Like, seriously. So I'll show you some things that we saw in the classic science fiction movies as I was growing up, and I'll ask you if you think that this actually happened or will happen in your lifetime and mine. Okay, so let's start with the absolute quintessential science fiction. This is Star Trek. As you can see, that phone on the right-hand side, the flip phone, if I could call it, was a device that he used to talk to people over wireless connections. And the one on the left is a very, very rudimentary attempt at a tablet. Okay, did I give that away? Did that happen in your lifetime and mine? Raise your hand. Of course, it's science fact. Now, let's play that game. Let's take this. Remember, that was what? Minority Report, I think, 2004, maybe. Tom Cruise waving at his computer. Gestures were understood by the computer as an interface. Do you think this will happen in your lifetime and mine? Of course. It happened in 2009. It's on every Xbox, Nintendo, and everything else. This is one of my favorites, iRobot, 2007, sitting in the car before, not driving, just bored like hell, falling asleep before the robots start to attack him in another car that is driven by itself. Do you think that is going to happen in your lifetime? And oh, there you go. Self-driving cars are real. This one is a bit tricky. So they used to call a molecular synthesizer. So it basically creates something out of thin air. In that case, a glass full of water. Do you think this will happen in your lifetime and mine? Now, no hands. Not a single hand? This is a trick question. So, yeah, okay, thank you. This already happened. If you haven't heard of 3D printing, you're missing out on something. So yes, and by the way, we are capable of printing things like that if we wanted to. I think the only idea is there is no economic model to it, but you can print everything from chocolate to concrete to tools on the space shuttle. It's already happening in your lifetime and mine. Let's take the more controversial ones, telepathy. Telepathy is for me to look at you and read what's on your mind without you opening your mouth. Do you think this will happen in your lifetime? Oh yeah, of course, it's happening already. It's called WhatsApp, right? So I do that all the time with lots of people around the world. I just have to use a keyboard and a screen, and there is a lot of research that tells us this will not be needed in the near future. The other one is teleportation. So you basically beam me here from London instead of me being in London and then flying through Heathrow and getting delayed for an hour, like every time I fly through Heathrow. So do you think that will happen? Will I be able to get into a cylinder and then be beamed here for you to see me? No believers in quantum physics. It doesn't need quantum physics, it needs virtual reality. As a matter of fact, if you were okay with wearing a head-mounted display today, you could have seen me exactly like you see me right now. Every technology that is needed to do this in virtual reality is available. And if you keep that virtual reality idea in mind, then Avatar is possible, and Back to the Future is possible. So I could literally swipe through my head-mounted display. I've done that on experiments when I was at Google. Swipe through my head-mounted display and go back into New York in 1920. Okay? It's very doable. everything that you've ever seen, I would actually say everything, but probably most things that you've ever seen in your young age, growing up, watching science fiction has already happened, right? Now, the question is, why have you not raised your hand when I asked you if it will happen or not? For a very, very simple reason. We tend to take those things for granted. We actually don't notice how much of a science fiction world we're living in. So let me show you this. How many of you have ever used that one on the left here? Yeah, you see, has anyone not used a telephone with a dial on it? Okay, everyone has used this. This was the way we communicated 50 years ago, and this was shown in Google I.O. last year. This is a woman, and this is an AI.
For a client. I'm looking for something on May 3rd. Sure, give me 1 second.
That's your AI?
Sure, what time are you looking for around? At 12 p.m. We do not have a 12 p.m. available. The closest we have to that is a 1:15.
Do you have anything between 10 a.m. and 12 p.m.?
Depending on what service she would like, what service is she looking for?
Just a woman's haircut for now.
Okay, we have a 10 o'clock.
10 a.m. is fine.
Okay, what's her first name?
The first name is Lisa.
Okay, perfect. So I will see Lisa at 10 o'clock on May 3rd.
Okay, great. Thanks.
Great. Have a great day. Bye.
Right, with all of the tonalities, with all of the human features, this is not an experimental service. When Google announced this, they announced that it was going to be calling small businesses periodically to ask about opening and closing times to update Google Maps. Right? So if you have a small business, you might have received one of those calls. You have no idea that they're living among us. Right? And for some reason, you have been doing some of those things for many years. We've interacted with machines in AI-like ways for many, many years, but we just take it for granted. And the reason why we take it for granted is they happen within the speed of one human lifetime. Okay? So somehow, if I gave you one more grain of rice in your plate of rice every day, you actually wouldn't feel it when I give you a plate that is this big, right? This is what's been happening to us. We've been fed technology so slowly that we actually don't notice the big differences. The only way to notice the big differences is what I call the speed challenge, which is to take a big picture view of what's happening. This is a chart that is known as the product adoption curve. Everyone knows this. If you've ever studied marketing, every product that we've ever released in life will start first to be adopted very slowly. These are the early adapters, and then zoop, it goes like a hockey stick upwards until it saturates when it reaches a certain level of penetration. Here I have shown technologies like the radio, the telephone, the TV, and the internet. So the thing to notice here is if you compare any two technologies, here I've taken, say, the internet and the TV, it took 100 years for TV to reach a certain level of household penetration that took the internet 15 to reach. Okay, so in a very, let me go back to this slide. So in a very, if I can, I, yeah, there you go. So it took 100 years for TV to do what the internet did in 15, to do what Facebook did in 7. Huh? So if you want to think of Christianity as a technology, it took Jesus 2,000 years to reach a billion people. It took Larry Page somewhere around 15. Okay? And that's the pace of how fast things are going. Okay? Now, that speed challenge is the result of a few interesting curves. One of them is what I call the technology acceleration curve. So let's take two industries. I am a very, very interested person in cars. I've built a few myself. I love the technology behind them. I love the mechanics behind them. This is the history of cars. Audi is one of my favorites from an engineering point of view. This is the Auto Union. It had 56 horsepowers, if I remember. The breakthrough of Audi was the Quattro. It had somewhere around 200 and some horsepowers. The R8 has something like 560. And this is the Bugatti Chiron. later on, which is from the VW Audi group, which has 1,500 horsepower. Now, if you look at that technology acceleration curve, it looks quite impressive, and it goes in tens of increments. Huh? So this new car is somewhere, if I can read correctly, at 30x the engine power of the one that was 50 to 60 years ago. Now, that's quite impressive. Look at technology in what I call the exponential growth industries. So take the microprocessor. I'm not even interested to tell you the history of that, because if any of you have ever used a Sinclair or a Commodore or an Intel 8088, you know what I'm talking about. Okay? You know that I had a 5.25-inch diskette, if you remember that. That is not even enough to have one image of one of you on it today, and we wrote code on it, right? And that acceleration curve is in the hundreds of thousands or million-fold the performance. Okay? Of course, all of us know this as Moore's Law, or what is now more known as the technology acceleration curve, which basically means that technology will double in its capacity every 18 months at the same price. Right? And we've held true to Moore's Law since we started. As a matter of fact, you know, some people debate that processors are getting to reach the physical limit, but of course we're opening up to things like cloud computing and multi-threaded computing, and things like the quantum computing, which is actually not that far off, which would take that into leaps and bounds of new growth. Okay? So that technology acceleration curve basically means that once you're ready, technologies will actually grow exponentially for a very long time. The other side of this is something I call the technology participation curve, which is something that started, I would tend to believe, since the beginning of the internet, which was a result of the democratization of information, tools, and commerce. Okay? So the world we live in today, which again we take for granted, is very different than the world I started to code computers in. Because in this world, everyone who has a phone or any access to computers is able to innovate because they have endless access to tools. Most of them are free or very, very cheap in cloud computing. They have infinite access to data. And if they can build something worthwhile, they have an infinite access to the world to sell it to. So commerce is everywhere in the world. That's why you have so many technologies that are coming from places like Ukraine and India and so on and so forth, being sold everywhere else in the world. Everyone can innovate, but interestingly, not everyone does it very well. And now that is the core of my presentation. Why is it that Google can come out of Silicon Valley, but not of Copenhagen? Okay? And in my view, and I say that with respect, by the way, because I struggled with that in my part of the world, huh? Why is it? Are people smarter? Why? Let's say it differently. Why does Google come out of Silicon Valley, but not out of Korea, which in my view is one of the most innovative nations on the planet? They're so smart, it blows you away, right? And I think there are two reasons for that. Reason number one is what I call the foresight challenge. And the foresight challenge is this. If you knew today that a highway was going to be established or constructed from here to a point in the middle of nowhere, you would, by definition, start to buy property or do plans related to this highway. Okay? But if you didn't, you would have to wait until the highway is constructed, and then you would start to buy those properties there. It's a little too late already. Okay? When it's a little too late, it's a little too expensive, there are a little too many players, and it becomes a little difficult. And so the foresight challenge is the idea of, can you know what is about to happen, not what already happened? Okay? And so that, in my view, follows a typical hockey stick curve. A bit of momentum. We try to solve the problem, we try to establish this new technology, then a point of breakthrough, and after that breakthrough, it starts to be accessible for everyone to use it. Now, the only interesting side of the technology development curve, as I call it, is it doesn't look like that, it rather looks like this. So technology takes a massively long time to be developed until the point it's ready to break out. Okay? And that, you know, an AI example, because we're talking about AI today, just to understand, huh? AI is nothing new. It's everything we talk about now, but in 1956, AI started. Okay? It was called the Dartmouth Experiment. Everyone committed to make computers more intelligent, and then they tried and tried and tried. As a young programmer, it was my absolute dream. And then by 1973, which was called the first AI winter, the economic crisis slowed us all down. Right? Then Japan started again in 1980. By 1987, the second AI winter, it slowed us all down. Only until the turn of the millennium. Only until the turn of the millennium, when we started to find things like deep learning, like unprompted AI, like commerce, commercial applications of AI, did we actually start to get true AI breaking out. And now it's all over the place. Right? So now it's from, you know, someone who's trying to build, unfortunately, build a super intelligent weapon, to super intelligent surveillance, to just a better way to fit you with a blouse. Right? And all of that is happening because the breakthrough happened, because we now know what's going on. Right? Now, that foresight challenge, I believe there are five technologies you need to be aware of. I'm not going to talk about them in detail, I'm almost sure. You know all of them. Of course, machine learning is one. This is the topic of today. Robotics is another, but robotics not in the way that we understand it from science fiction movies. Robotics are simply AI-controlled hardware, if you want. Okay, so the AI is the software side of it. Machines that are robotic-like are machines that are able to make physical decisions based on AI, and a self-driving car is an example of that. It doesn't look like a humanoid, but it is a car that makes decisions on its own. Right? Robotics, I believe, is about to break through because the hardware is starting to become cheaper and cheaper and cheaper, and so it's going to get into synergies very quickly. Virtual and augmented reality, do not ignore that. It had a rough start because of the dorkiness of the headsets, but you know, if you haven't seen the new Google app on Google Maps where you raise your phone and it will give you directions in the real image of the world, try that. Augmented reality is definitely incredibly valuable in the enterprise space, and this is going to take our life to a very different direction. Then there is what I call life sciences, which is the merger between biology and computer science. Everything in this body, believe it or not, is actually computer science. It's just massive sets of data, 3 billion records for the DNA, monitoring devices, and so on and so forth. So this is about to break through. And then finally, what most people don't believe in is the blockchain, is the wrong name, but I think the reinvention of finance is right about the corner. Don't ignore that. I think this is going to change a lot of things. Now, let me talk to you about, so consider those as your tools. Let me talk to you about how to put it together. So if you take the technology development curve, the technology acceleration curve, and the technology participation curve, you would find that the opportunities to create sci-fact are becoming very, very, very real. As a matter of fact, when I worked at Google X, I believed that everything is possible. There's almost no problem that can be thrown at us today that we couldn't solve for technology. Most of the time, there could be an economic barrier, but the other reason is really why some nations innovate and some nations don't. And that's what I call the mindset challenge. Okay? That also applies to some companies innovate and some companies don't. The mindset challenge is this. If I had shown my fellow pharaohs, I'm from Egypt, if I had shown them the possibility to build the pyramids differently, they would have said, no, we would much rather just add more slaves to the job. The technology they had at the time was managing slaves, and they would have just added 50,000 more slaves. Right? If I had told the pharaoh that your car can go faster by a different technology, he would have just said, I have 12 horses, I might as well add another two. He wouldn't have thought of a Bugatti Veyron or a Bugatti whatever with 1,500 horses instead of 12, and he wouldn't have thought of cement. Okay? Why? Because we tend to underplay the possibilities of the future. We tend, like this idea from the 70s, I think, Edward de Bono, the Six Thinking Hats, if you remember that book, we tend to think to wear the black hat first before we wear the yellow hat. We tend to look for what's not going to work first, and when we do that, we end up not working on the problem because we think of the problems. Okay? We don't think of the possibilities that are associated with the problem. And as a matter of fact, the biggest thing I've learned at Google was that every problem is a $1 trillion opportunity. If you can solve a problem, you can actually change the world, which is a good thing, and make a lot of money in the process. So what the mindset challenge is, if you wear the black hat first, you start to end up with incremental innovation. You start to prioritize the stuff that you can actually do easily within your capability. So, you know, a nation like Korea would develop better and better LED TVs, okay? Instead of reinventing the TV altogether. And that mindset challenge needs to be understood differently. I'll take an example from the car industry around safety, okay? So there is no doubt that the car industry innovated heavily in the last 100 years. When it came to safety, they started first with something that was called crashworthiness. When cars, even the Model T, would kill people at 30 kilometers an hour, so they started to make cars crashworthy, so that when the car crashes, you survive, okay? Which is such a weird name, huh? It's like, now you can crash this one. Right? And so it's really interesting because, of course, they did really well. Airbags and traction control and so on and so forth. Crash avoidance came later, which was, hey, maybe we should actually make the lights work better or make the ABS brakes work better. Maybe that will avoid the crash. Okay? Until Google came out and said 90% of the reason why we have accidents is human error. So maybe we should replace the human and have self-driving cars. That's a very unusual way of looking at the problem. When we did that, we didn't have the geodata. I continue to say we, because I always will be part of Google. You know, we didn't have the geodata, we didn't have the robotic technology, we didn't have the processing power, we didn't have the AI, but that was 8 years before those things were going to happen, and now those cars are actually driving the streets endlessly. Now, that approach is what I call radical innovation. And to close and give you something to think about, I want to say that for you to build the next Google here in Denmark, you need to change three things that you can actually change in this place before you leave this room. Okay? And those are the following. One, assume that everything's possible. Because it is, I promise you. It is. There is not a single problem in our world today that we cannot solve with technology. The second is commit to the problem. And this probably is the biggest mind shift I want to get you to think about. Every one of us, because of capitalism, when we think of a new innovation, of a new startup, of a new business, we think of how much money are we going to make. We think of what's the business plan. We think of the product. Can I build a better dating app? Can I build a better photo sharing app? Who needs another dating app? What problem are you trying to solve? Right? The question is, can you focus on a problem? Can you take a problem and say, this is what I'm going to champion. I'm going to not rest until that problem is solved completely. Larry Page used to teach us this by saying, it's called the toothbrush test. If you can find a problem that affects a billion people or more, solve it in a way where they actually like your solution so much that they use it twice a day, you're bound to make a lot of money and change the world in the process. So I'm now championing a problem in my current startup that is about making consumerism responsible. Okay? It's a massive problem when you think about it. Our planet is going to end because we're consuming too much. We're consuming wrong. We're wasting too much. Okay? So my company is called Today, which is basically to say, take action today so that we can make consumerism successful, winning for the retailer, winning for the consumer, winning for everyone, but responsible at the same time. That's an interesting problem. It's going to take us time to solve, but if one of us champions it, everyone will follow. Champion a problem. And when you do that, I think you should urge yourself to commit to radical innovation. Okay? You commit to radical innovation by rejecting incremental innovation. That's the only way to do it. When someone walks into your office and says, I have a good idea that's going to improve things by 5%, 7%, 20%, even 100%, that's not good enough. That's not good enough because within that 100% range, you're just applying incremental innovation. You haven't forced yourself out of your comfort zone to say there is a way to completely reinvent this thing. What if consumerism was invented today? Not in the 1900s, it was invented today. How could we actually invent it today? What if air travels was invented today? What if money was invented today? Okay? What if we had no legacy? How would you build it? And of course, if you'd give yourself a target, you would give yourself a target of what I call, or what we used to call in Google X, 10x. And 10x is a target that basically stretches you to say, I want a 10x improvement on the current environment. And until I get that, maybe I haven't stretched my mind enough. With that in mind, I would say everyone, regardless of any industry, can find the problem to solve. Our world is full of problems, okay? I mean, when we were talking about the idea of AI and ethics, that's a massive problem. Single-use plastic, massive problem. Equality, massive problem. Education, massive problem. Champion one, take one, okay? And make the world better. I think you're gonna make a lot of money in the project, in the process. Thank you.